morning, everyone. This worship is open to all, and we hope that sharing together will be a blessing to you. There are moments where you are invited to join in at home, speaking the words in bold, out loud, or inside, and singing along to the hymns. You might also like to pause and light a candle before we begin, as a sign of setting this time aside for something special. And today you might like to have wine and bread or a suitable alternative available so that you can share in the Holy Communion. My name is Ron Battista and I'm your worship leader. Reverend Malcolm Rawlings will bring us the message, and we have Roy Turner who will read the scripture, and I also will be managing the video production. We also thank all the other members of their congregation that assist us each week to bring this Sunday worship. Normally I would say, after the service, please come and share in some companionship with us in the rear hall. But of course, in these lockdown times due to COVID-19, that won't be happening. So instead, please make an effort to contact the people by phone that you normally sit next to on a Sunday morning. Give them a ring and just ask them how they're going. We did not have weekly news sheets at this time, but Daryl, our chairman, is sending out regular emails to our congregation. If you are not on the list, please contact us through our website, which has our contact phone number, and request your name to be added, and we'll make sure that you get an email. This week's news, there is a memorial service for Robert Hayes on June 26th. With a time to be confirmed. It'll be in the morning. There's also a memorial service for Ruth Hayden on Tuesday the 9th at 11 a.m. At this stage, both will be attendances only by invitation, as we need to manage the attendance numbers. Our church council has advised we are preparing to restart some activities, such as prayer group and Monday Bible studies. Some of our hall users, like Brighton Calisthenics, are preparing to resume their activities as well. Worship in the church will not start until the limit of 20 people in any one room is increased. Our church will be able to cater for 44 people. So we're strictly applying all the government directions regarding physical distancing, hand hygiene, and recording attendance for any activity that begins again. Finally, I would like to acknowledge the many emails and messages sent to me by the congregation members, thanking us for the production of the online worship service. There is a team of us involved in preparing the worship week, and we thank you very much for your kind words, which are greatly appreciated. And now our call to worship. Creation, the moon, the stars, the sun, the sky, the hills, the seas. Beauty abounds before our eyes. Gather round as we come before our Creator God, maker of all we see and hear, smell and touch. Gather round as we wonder again at our story of creation. And now a responsive section. Father God of creation, we wonder at your handiwork. Son of the Creator, we wonder at your example. Creative Spirit, we wonder at your power. Holy creating Trinity, we bow down in wonder and awe. God made us, God shaped us, God has chosen us, God has sent us. May we go now to be makers of God's peace, shapers of God's love, choosers of God's way, and senders on the journey. And may God be ever with us, ever creating us, ever moulding us, ever calling us, and ever leading us. We gather today now to sing, trusting God can hear each one of us in our homes and blend our distant voices into one song of worship. 'Tis 6:31, Father, Lord of all creation, 'tis 6:31. Our prayers of thanksgiving and confession. God, there has been no time when you have not been creating, no space where you have not been imagining. Before our earliest ancestors existed, you were dreaming and designing what people could be. We were born into the flow of your creativity and breathe our every breath in your company. Come close to us. Come alive in us. Stir us like clouds caught by a summer breeze. May we cling to you like sweet peas to a fence and be as open to you as a blossoming sunflower to the sun. Give us our expansive vision of what our world is and can be. And let us move to the music of your resounding call. We surrender to you, abundant and almighty God, and offer you our worship. Amen. our prayer of thanksgiving. Thank you, God, for your immeasurably big heart. You don't need the credit for what you do. You don't need the recognition. You don't need the thanks. Where would we be without your refusal to despair, your resolve to never give up, your willingness to keep working to sustain the cosmos which you love? The ingenuity of your mind is unfathomable. How perfectly you set up all the ecosystems of Earth, the balances of climate and vegetation and interdependent species. How deep your trust in us, to implant in us the wisdom to care for the land and the sea, to be your co-workers in ensuring the flourishing of all. Thank you for the expertise of people who work most closely with the environment, ecologists and botanists, zoologists and conservationists. Thank you for the successes of the work they do and for their persistent efforts to educate and inform so that all of us know the habits we must get out of and get into for the protection, survival and well-being of the whole world. Our prayer of confession. Dear God, how does it happen? After all your constant, faithful, unconditional commitment to us, there are times we want to escape you, when we don't even know what gets in the way, when our closed minds are a mystery to ourselves, when our thinking gets clogged up with the pollution of self-hatred. Please will you come and speak some gentle sense to us again. When loving us is a thankless task, you watch our futile efforts to clean up our own act. Please would you prod us into noticing you down on your hunkers beside us, willing us to reach out and grab your hand. God, you know the bitter taste of failure. You fully understand the temptation to give up. You stay with us and quell all those gremlins of defeatism and pessimism and discouragement. You have forgiven us all for all that's gone wrong in our living and loving. Pick us up as we pick up our mats and walk on. So be it. Amen. And finally, our prayers of intercession. During this time of the COVID pandemic, we thank you for all that is good in life, for the love of family and friends, thank you. For the kindness of good neighbour and Samaritan, stranger, thank you. May those who are vulnerable, hungry or homeless experience support. May those who are sick know healing. May those who are anxious or bereaved sense comfort. Bless and guide political leaders and decision makers with wisdom. Bless and guide health workers and key workers with strength and well-being. Bless and guide each of us as we adapt to a new way of living. And may the light be shining from our windows, across the road, across the suburbs, and across our wide red land. May the light be reflected in our hearts and hands and hopes. In this incredible turmoil in the United States of America, we thank you for all that is good in life in our land and pray that America will soon return to what is good in its land. May those who are marginalized experience change in American society. May those who are hungry and homeless to obtain the support they need. May the outpouring of emotion through peaceful rallies and protest marches across all 50 states of America bring about a renewed and determined movement to bring about true social change. We pray the leaders in America will listen to their people. We pray for peace in America through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our first scripture reading this morning comes from the Old Testament, Psalm 8. Psalm 8. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouths of babes and infants, you have founded a bulwark because of your foes, to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them? Mortals, that you care for them. Yet you have made them a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honour. You have given them dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under their feet. All sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the sea. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second reading from the New Testament, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 16 to 20. Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 to 20. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
It's good for us to share in worship again today. Today we're reflecting upon the Trinity. Last week at Pentecost, we celebrated the coming of the Holy Spirit and all that that means for God's people. And yet we ponder and consider who God is and what this Trinity might mean. To help us in our understanding, particularly of the Holy Spirit, we're now going to watch a brief video. And I'd invite you to reflect upon the story of God's presence in our world today.
If you've ever heard the phrase, the Holy Spirit, and you want to know what it means, where do you start?
Well, you have to start on page one of the Bible, where the uncreated world is depicted as this dark, chaotic place. But then above the chaos, God's Spirit is there, hovering, ready to bring about life and order and beauty.
Okay, but what is God's Spirit?
Yeah, so the Spirit is the way the biblical authors talk about God's personal presence. The Hebrew word is ruach.
Ruach.
Yeah, you gotta clear your throat at the end.
So what is it?
Well, ruach can refer to a number of different things, but what they all have in common is energy.
Energy? How so?
So there's an invisible energy that makes the clouds move or the tree branches sway.
Right. Wind.
So in Hebrew, that's ruach.
Okay.
Now take a big breath. So you feel that inside you?
Yeah, the air?
Well, specifically the energy, right? The vitality in your body that you get from breathing deeply, that too is ruach. And this is the same word used in the Bible to describe God's personal presence. Just like wind and breath are invisible, God's Spirit is invisible. Wind is powerful, and so God's Spirit is powerful. And just as breath keeps us alive, so God's Spirit sustains all of life.
Yeah, ruach.
Now, as we continue on in the story of the Bible, we see God's ruach giving special empowerment to people for specific tasks. The first person in the Bible this happens to is Joseph.
God's Spirit enables him to understand and interpret dreams.
And then it happens to this guy named Bezalel, and he's an artist.
God's spirit empowers him with wisdom and skills. He's given creative genius to make beautiful things in the tabernacle.
And we also see God's ruach empower a group of people called the prophets.
They're able to see what's happening in history from God's point of view.
That's exactly right. And here's the problem as the prophets saw it. While God's ruach had created a really good world, humans have given in to evil. They've unleashed chaos into it through their injustice.
A new type of disorder.
Yes, and the prophet said the Spirit would come, just like in Genesis 1, but now to transform the human heart, to empower people to truly love God and others.
How will this new act of God's Spirit happen?
Well, centuries pass, and we are introduced to Jesus. And at the beginning of his mission, there's this beautiful scene where Jesus is being baptized in the waters of the Jordan River.
Yeah, the sky opens up and God's Spirit comes and rests on him like a bird.
This story is saying that God's Spirit is empowering Jesus to begin the new creation. And we see this happening when he heals people or forgives their sins. He's creating life where there once was death.
Now, Israel's religious leaders oppose Jesus and they eventually have him killed.
But even here, God's Spirit is at work. The earliest disciples of Jesus, who saw him alive from the dead, said it was God's energizing spirit that raised Jesus.
This is the beginning of new creation.
Yes, and it's still going. When Jesus appeared to his closest followers, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit."
And soon after that, the Spirit powerfully comes on all of his disciples.
So that they can become a part of this new creation and share the good news and learn how to live by the energy and influence of God's Spirit.
And so today, the Spirit is still hovering in dark places.
Yes, pointing people to Jesus, transforming and empowering them so they can love God and others. And the Christian hope is that the Spirit is going to finish the job. The story of the Bible ends with a vision of a new humanity, living in a new world that's permeated with God's love and life-giving Spirit.
Hey, thanks for watching this video on the Holy Spirit. This is one of many videos that we make where we take a biblical theme and trace it from the beginning to the end of Scripture.
The Bible Project is a nonprofit animation studio. You can watch all of our videos for free on YouTube, and you can help us make more by going to our website at jointhebibleproject.com.
Hopefully that video was helpful in giving you some insight into God's Spirit in our world and in our lives today. As we pause and reflect on the scripture reading that Roy brought to us, we pause and acknowledge Psalm 8, which reminds us that God is creator of all the universe, the entire cosmos, things in heaven and earth. And we see that God is a creator and that all things are connected. We find that there is that connection between everything that we know and understand. And that although we may not be able to see God and understand God clearly, there's something about God's presence or God's imprint, the touch of the artist in a world as we see it. We can see from the smallest atoms and the orbits of the neutron and the electron and the proton as we move slightly larger to the circle and spiral of water in the sink, to the cloud formations and the hurricane cloud formations as you look down from space and the spiral that circles around the world, to the orbits of the planets and to the galaxies that spiral out in space. We can see that there's a relationship, a connection from the tiniest thing to the largest thing that we know in our universe. There are spirals in flowers and in seashells. Life has the imprint of the divine within. Our God is a God of interconnection, interdependence. Psalm 8 speaks to us not only of God as creator, but our role that we were created lower than God, yet touched with God's image. We can see that within ourselves. And this God is a God of connections, of relationships. This is a God who continues to move in and through our world and encourages us to see the dependence and relationship that we have with each other, that we have with all of creation, with our world and life as we know it. Matthew's gospel are the words of Jesus before he leaves, speaking to the disciples and encouraging them to go and make known the gospel, to go and spread the truth, the good news of God that brings life and love and new hope to all people. There is unity and connection, and we go out in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. One God and yet three. Perhaps in the past we may have been focused that God we treat like a noun. God is Father, God is Son, God is Spirit. You may have seen an image of a triangle with the Father at the top, the Son at the side on the bottom, and the Spirit on the other side. We see that this is quite a lineal image, and it is logical and practical. And it only goes so far, for we understand little about who God is. And all our images and all our metaphors give us one concept or one idea. I would encourage us to think about God as a circle, as a spiral, a continual flow of love and grace. That God as Father interacts and engages with God as Son. That God as Son interacts with God as Father and Spirit. And so the relationship continues. It is one of self-sacrifice, of giving over and over and over again. We find that Matthew sends us out with the words of Jesus to go and make known the truth of God's presence, the truth of life. And rather than having boundaries or restrictions or legalistic understandings, that we can see the circle and the relationship that we have with all people, with all of creation, and that God's love and grace is something that flows from within us and out to be cycled and flow back towards us again and again and again. God is beyond our understanding. God shows to us images of who God can be as we pause and reflect. We may reflect that our God is a loving God. Well, yes, that's true, but only partly true if we understand that that means that we define God as a God or a being who loves. The truth of the scriptures is that it is not that God loves, but God is love. God is being, God is life, energy and power, forgiveness, grace, vulnerability, serving and generosity. God cannot be anything else, for God is love. And this is a flow that connects and relates to all of our creation, to all of our world. As we pause and try to understand something more of God as Trinity this day, may we seek to see God at work in our lives and in our world. May we see that Jesus saves and redeems our world, and as part of God's image within us, may our lives seek to save and redeem the world around us. May through our energy, through our life, through our generosity, through our sacrifice, may we seek to make this world a better place as we trust in God's Spirit who resides within us, who blesses us and who empowers us. Someone has said that perhaps we can think of God as Father above us, that Jesus as God beside us and Spirit as God within us. This is another image which is good, and it inspires us to see God at work in us and around us. So as we continue to share in worship, as we continue to live our lives, may whatever context and circumstance, wherever we may be, may we seek to live a life of acknowledgement that God is within, that God is outside, and that we can relate to each other and make a blessing in the world that God has given to us. Let us recognize God at work, present, permanent, constant, giving, and gracious in our lives. Amen. Here is an invitation for us to share together in Holy Communion. I'd ask that at home, if you would wish, that you have some elements, a piece of bread or a biscuit or a cracker, and some liquid to share, as we would acknowledge God's presence through his Son, Jesus Christ. We have an invitation. Come, all of you who are weary and need a rest. Come, all of you who are passionate and need a place of encouragement. Come, all of you who are stressed and need a place to lay down your tasks, if only for a moment. Come, all of you who are burned at the edges and need a place of sanctuary. Come because God loves you. Come because you love God. God is here. We are here, and we journey in faith together. The Lord be with you. And also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. We thank you, God, that from the beginning you made the world and all its creatures. You made people to live for you and for each other. And so we praise you, O God. You created humanity in your image, giving the gift of freedom. You showed Noah the rainbow. You gave strength to Moses to free his people and taught Miriam to sing. You gave courage to Esther and loyalty to Ruth. You helped David to defeat the giant and gave him a harp to sing. We praise you, O God. And even though they turned away from you and forgot about you, so we do too. But you did not forget. You sent your only child, Jesus, to the world to show how much you love us and to bring us back to you again. We praise you, O God. As one of us, Jesus came, at first a helpless infant, then a child, a youth, and an adult. He rejoiced with those who rejoiced, and he wept with those who wept. To the despairing, he spoke a word of hope. To the sick, he gave healing. To the rejected, a friend. And yet he was betrayed and nailed to a cross. But he was lifted from the grave and restored to life, that he might be with us and we with him, alive forevermore. And so we praise you with the faithful of every time and place, joining with the choirs of angels and the whole of creation in the eternal hymn. Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And so, as Jesus broke the bread and shared the wine, revealing before his friends the powerful, shy reality of God, we do likewise, so as to be astonished anew and transformed yet again. In his letter to the Corinthians, Paul tells us how the ritual began. On the night of his betrayals, Jesus took bread, gave God thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you. Take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to each of them, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." So God of love, send your Holy Spirit upon us and what we do here, that we and these signs, touched by your Spirit, may be signs of life and love for ourselves and for others and to all the world. Come, Holy Spirit, through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, God most holy, now and forever. Amen. And here we have an opportunity to share together. We share the bread and the cup. Let us drink together. Loving God, we draw closer to you, seeking that we may be found, centered in your grace, enfolded in your love, reflecting your light in the world. So let us leave this time and this table as the beloved children of God, knowing that God travels with us in the name of the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Amen. Now is a time for us to pause and reflect upon the prayers for others, for our world, for our community, for our homes, for ourselves. As today we've considered the circle image or the spiral image in nature, an opportunity for us to pray for others using that format. I'd encourage us to start at the circle of ourselves and to spiral out as we pause to remember and pray for those around us. So here and now, let us pray for ourselves, here in our home or the room where we live. May we come before God and seek God's grace and blessing for us. As we continue in prayer, may we extend that circle as it spirals out, and may we be aware of our neighbours, those in the houses or the rooms along the corridor from us. And may we pause and remember them by name and reflect upon their needs and their family contexts. May we seek to bless those around us as we would pause to pray for others. Continuing in prayer, as we move beyond our neighbourhood, let us consider our city, our lovely city of Adelaide, and the needs of those around us, the needs around our city, as we face the relaxing of restrictions and as people engage more in the community, as clubs and groups and sporting activities increase. May our prayers focus on those around us. Let's widen the circle as we consider our state, the state of South Australia and those who are in leadership, our politicians and the experts who are seeking to guide us in the release of our restrictions, our hospitals. As we pause and reflect across our state of those in rural communities and the struggles and the economy as we face the challenges ahead. Continuing in prayer, we would expand our circle to go into our country. Australia, we think of our national politicians. We think of the government that would guide and lead us. We pray for our economy, for the jobs and for the challenges that many people across our country face. Continuing in prayer, we go to our world and the challenges and struggles that our world in many countries is facing with COVID, its toll upon their communities, the illnesses and the death. And we think right across our world in many countries, the protests where people are gathering to support those who have been abused and affected by governments and by law systems. We pray for those who are facing natural disasters and the challenges that our world and humanity and all of creation is facing in our modern day world. So as we have been praying and we breathed out in wider circles, we see that there is a boundary there, and so we take a breath and we breathe back in. And we find that our circles continue to shrink and to come back to where our prayers are on ourselves. Our life is in the image of breathing in and breathing out and breathing in and breathing out. And so may our prayers today be focused upon the centre, out through those that we are aware of and have relationship with, to the ends of the earth, and then back again as we recognise God's grace and blessing. As people of God, we pray and remember each other. So let us draw our time of prayer to a close by sharing in the prayer that Jesus taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And our final hymn today is a modern hymn, Praise and Worship 723. There is a Redeemer. Praise and Worship 723. It's been good to share in worship with you again today. As you go out into the world, whatever you do for the rest of this day, for the rest of this week, may you see the flow of God's grace and blessing upon your life. And may you share that in relationship with those that you meet. May you continue to support our world and community in prayer. Let us go in God's name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.